Right. So, good afternoon again, everybody. This is your first management case study class. And as I mentioned to you, what we will be going through is first your exam writing skills and exam techniques, because that's one of the most important things that we have to go through. And the next section that we will be going through is your analyzing your case study. All right, so there are two lecturers that will be taking your class. That'll be myself, Andrew, and then we've got Sandy who will be taking your class as well. So if so 1 second, yeah. So what I will do now is share my screen with you in order to demonstrate to you what is the exam technique that the examiner is looking for. Okay, so you should be able to see my screen right now. One second. Right. So, this is a bit of an introduction about myself, who I am, and I'm basically a SEMA graduate, as you can say. I've got my CPA as well, did my MBA with University of Manchester, specializing in finance. I do have the qualification from
Andrew,
Chartered
your
Institute of
screen.
Marketing as well.
Andrew,
Yes.
have you shared your screen? Because I don't.
I'm
I'm getting another
sharing
message in WhatsApp
the
to ask
screen with you.
I'm getting a
Can
message in WhatsApp to ask
everybody
me.
else see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So the others can see it. Gavin? Okay. So one of the other things that I specialize in is information technology. So I have been in the information technology space for over 15 years. So and your case study is on information technology, that industry. So we can have a lot of discussions. I can impart quite a bit of knowledge in that space as well. Okay, so this case study really interested me, but some of the others have told me they're not very keen on this case study. But it depends, I guess, you know, where you're coming from. Now, we need to look at the four competencies, right? This is one of the key things that you need to consider when you're writing your answer. The four competencies will definitely help you. It provides you the guidance. Now, when you start your answers, you need to have a definite structure. We need to follow a particular answer plan. Now, if you don't do that, it's bound to fail, because in your area they're emphasizing more on the technical skills, less on business people and leadership. But then you need to demonstrate the technical skills. You need to be aware of it. Doesn't mean that you only focus on the technical skills and forget the other three. If you do that, you're bound to fail as well, right? So you need to be quite conscious of what you need to how you need to structure your answer. And that's the reason why we go on emphasizing that you guys do a answer plan. So when I get you to do answer plans in class, I give you 10 minutes to do the answer plan, right? So during that 10 minutes, I want to see how you structure your answer plan. So it is preferred that you're not on your mobile and that you're on a laptop or a desktop, so that you can write your answer on in Word or something, and then you can show that to us, share your screen and show it to us as well. And that way you're bound to improve in your answer, the writing skills, right, and the exam technique. Now, let us go into the next area. The examiner is looking at the four competencies there. What are they? If you look at the technical skills, they're looking at the financial statement, analysis, interpretation of your financial statements, and you know, giving a good context to those. If there is investment appraisals, and the pros and cons of investment appraisal methods, and you need to know those. And of course, the business valuation, when it comes to financial reporting, the integrated reporting as well, which is a new thing that's in business nowadays. We'll come to that later on. Looking at financing, debt, equity, the risks. You can look at financing from a business perspective, the risks associated with it, as well as from a project perspective and the risk associated with that particular project, right? So in that context, your cost of capital may change. Then you also look at the risk cycle. You not only would you just mention the risk associated with a project or within the company, you also need to talk about how do you mitigate these risks, right? One of the things that the examiner has mentioned is the students are good at identifying the risks, but they need to say how it is mitigated, right? And corporate governance, of course, plays a major role in our lives. We come to that. I have separate areas around corporate governance. We look at internal audit, fraud, the controls as well. Now, you can see there's quite a bit of area where you know, you need to show your skills, and because most of your areas, the technical skills are greater in this exam than the strategic one, where it is 25%, but yours is much greater, but your other competencies are lesser. Now, when we look at any particular project, we need to look at or investment, we need to look at the business people leadership, and what does business mean? It means the five forces. You need to understand what they are, the diamond model, the pest factors. You need to analyze the shares, the stakeholders as well, and these are some of the models that are there for you to analyze, understand the stakeholders, and then you look at the options available to a company, right? Well, how do you evaluate these options? We have good structure that we can use through Porter's, ANSOF, and BCG value chain. These are the kind of models that can help you structure that answers, right? Then we also have got the rationale model, which is emergent or freewheeling. This is the kind of strategic models that we can use. We will see what is the most appropriate for your industry. Then we also look at human resources management, TQM. There's a lot of opportunity for us to talk about the quality circles, the TQM in our case study, balanced scorecard, that's also there, shareholder value analysis, and of course the traditional control methods, right? When it comes to people, we're looking at how to manage them, how to basically motivate them, influence them, right? And then we'll also look at certain situations, how does the ethical CSR factors impact, right? Now, people, we can also look at your purchasing strategies, what you have, and how the CSR is linked to that as well. We'll come to that, because we need to look at the value chain. Then we look at, you know, are you purchasing ethically? You know, how does it work? We can look at all those things, and it will fall under ethics and people. Right. Negotiating skills, influencing skills is also quite important. You can see in your case study you're dealing with multiple stakeholders, and you are basically working very closely with big manufacturers as well as very big clients that, you know, so therefore you need to understand what their needs are. Right, and also negotiate well. Leadership, we look at the different types of leadership that's required in, according to the situations, and we then look at the kind of teamwork required. Again, you will see we need that collaboration if you're working with different stakeholders and on different large projects, right? And then of course we will come across change management. Change management does play a significant role here, because project management, change management is quite important in your area, and we have the opportunity to use them as well. Okay, any of these models that you're not familiar with, just let me know these things you're not familiar with, so that I can go a little bit deeper into these, right? So any questions, or you want to comment at this point saying, yes, I need a little bit more on different type of models, because I will take it at another class, but it'll be good for me to know. Right, if there is no one, I'm going to the next slide. Then this, we are looking at when we, again, a little bit more on the business skills, right? What do you mean by business skills? It means, if there is a particular initiative, does it fit with the goals of the company? Because the company has a mission, and the mission will, the strategies you develop will align to the mission of the company. And also, you need to, the goals are linked to that strategy, right? So then we will look at what business model that we can use. Sorry, I want to put somebody on. So basically, if you guys can please mute your mics, because, 1 second, all right. Right, so what we are looking at is, then we look at the economic, is it economics of this particular initiative? Is it feasible? How does it impact your profit, cash flow, and share price? Because how do we get funds for this particular initiative? How can we pay back, right? So financing it, then operationally running it, these are things to consider. How will it affect you in a social sense? How does it impact your corporate social responsibility, whatever the initiative is? And then you look at, from a technology perspective, is it right timing, and when will this impact come in, right? And of course you look at particular job roles. By you bringing on this initiative, would it impact certain roles, certain departments? Will it change certain areas altogether? It does happen these days with automation and certain things that's happening in the market. It disrupts the current structure that has been there for a long time, right? We look at the people skills. We need to look at how would the stakeholders be interested in this. And we, when we say stakeholders, there are multiple, right? Anybody who is interested in us, that's what it is. And we will go into another model that will give you an analysis, help you to analyze these stakeholders. And the ethical issues will come about. We look at the professional behavior that we need to showcase in a particular situation. Then business, how ethical are you in your dealings as a corporate citizen? And competitors' behavior as well is something that we need to consider. We look at leadership, right? And leadership we look at in multiple ways to see what is the vision of the company, and then we look at in different situations that leadership characteristics may differ. And also, if you think of growth, you know, if you're looking at going into a different country, or you know, the leadership in that particular country that you need to adapt to may also change. So just because we adopt one kind of leadership in one country does not mean that you need to have to follow the same thing in another one, right? Team building, I think, is going to be quite critical for us, because we will be working with teams not only within our company but across different companies in order to work together to bring a particular product for a client, right? So because of that, we'll need to have very good communication skills, change management and negotiating skills as well. So more on leadership, and we just mentioned the change leadership, because this will play a significant role. I want to ask you guys if you're aware of change management. So at this point, I want to pause a while and ask some of you guys, what do you mean by change management? Wilfred, from you? Are you able to tell me? So let me say who else is available. So Gavin, anything from you?
Yeah, the change management is you're undertaking a project, and the process of company moving forward, leaders taking the company through this process, different techniques. I'm not very sure, but you know, you have an unfreeze board, then you feed back again, so you do the change and then freeze it,
right?
Freeze them back. It's the different techniques that you take the company through,
right? Yeah, anything from you, Kumari?
Sorry, Anju, I'm like a bit outdated.
Right, that's fine, that's okay. Wilfred, how about you? Change management. The reason I'm asking is it is quite important in your case studies, and I want to see how familiar you are with it. If not, that's also fine, because then we are in a position to take a call and say, well, this is some area that we need to go down a little bit deeper. Wilfred, anything from you?
Basically, when there is a change, say there is a redundancy issues and all those things, like how the company will take the pressure and how we need to encourage and support other employees to stay together as a team.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a good answer, because what you're saying is, the organizational changes, bringing in a new application, these all create changes, right, in the organization. It's a case of how quickly do the employees adapt to this change and embrace it and then be productive. The sooner they get productive, the better it is for us as an employer. Right, so as employers, what we will do, or managers, what we will do is to have a program which will incorporate these changes very fast and see, have change agents as well helping us bring these employees and, take them through this journey and get them to be where we want them to be, right? So that's the reason why education, communication, involvement, supporting them, then this is quite an important task. We did mention about Mandelos made, we did mention about stakeholders. And with stakeholders, what we have to do is we need to understand who are the stakeholders who are high power, high interest, right? Because these are key, very important people who can really stop our work, right? Stop us doing something. So in order to lobby and get their support and work with them, it's important that we understand first, who these guys are, and also then develop a communication strategy in order to work with them. Right. Have you got any examples that you can give me of these people who are working? Any examples? Or examples of where it has not worked? I think that's a better one. If you can say, well, you know what, we had this thing, we didn't engage them properly, this is what happened. Have you got any examples?
And you're talking about live examples.
Yeah.
Cases that have gone wrong.
Yes. So I can give you one example. When there was in one of the companies that I worked for, they had an organizational restructure, and that was within the IT IT functional area. There was an org restructure, but since it was not very well communicated to not only the internal people, internal to IT, but also to people who are outside of IT, there was a lot of chaos, right? Because the people in IT itself didn't know what their roles were, their new roles, how they were supposed to perform. Because suddenly you're in the same organization, working with the same people, but what you're supposed to be is to be doing is very different, right, than what you did yesterday. So this created a lot of confusion and then blaming people and chaotic situation, because it was not very well communicated, structured, right? And as a result, the business also suffered, because IT is an enabler and IT was not able to support the business appropriately, right? So it created a lot of problems. So if you got any examples like that, you want to share, it will be very good for us to share so that you can understand what it is, right? And sometimes people in low power, low interest, right, is something. Low power but high interest are people you need to give information, because and engage quite well, because few of them get together, they become high power, high interest, right? Because already they have high interest, but as soon as they all get together, quite a number of people, they're in a position to perform as high power, high interest, right? Can you give me an example of one group that you can think might...
Low power, low high interest?
Low power, high interest, yes.
So environmental groups?
Correct. And also sometimes the local community, individuals, right? Because as an individual, I might be very interested, but I don't have that amount of power. But then I get together with quite a number of people, then I'm in a good position to go into that high power, high interest group, right? So again, you need to be quite cognizant about, you know, actually what the stakeholder is, you know, how the stakeholder will perform, behave. We look at Porter's five forces. Now, why would you look at Porter's five forces in this case? Somebody answer me. Wow, this will link to our case study. Anyone who can give me an answer?
Because it is a competitive market.
Yes, very good. Yeah, so we are in a very competitive market, right? It says we have generic products. How do we differentiate it? That's the key. So you need to understand these forces and see how can we create opportunity, work with the forces. How can we do that? How can we make it better? Right, rather than be very reactive to the forces, we need to act being very proactive to these forces. Right, now can you give me another generic product, right, a very common generic product that has got differentiated? Give me an example. And we come across plenty of these. Correct, exactly. Coffee is a very, very generic product, which is available across, you know, supermarkets, everywhere else, but you can differentiate it. So how can you differentiate it? Sorry, you got to speak a bit louder.
Yeah, I think what they have done is like Starbucks has created an experience around the coffee.
Correct. Yes. Yes. Coffee is one thing.
Yeah.
Then you surround yourself with everything, a lot of other things, right? So that's how you create that differentiation, right? This is that Lewin's change model that I think Gavin was alluding to before, where you unfreeze, move to the desired state, and then refreeze. Right, basically what it's saying is you got, you know, you're used to doing something in a particular way. Now you need to break that habit, change it, get them used to doing something in a different way, right? This is the way you want them to do. And then once they are getting comfortable with that, you refreeze, or you make it very kind of, you have that as the key thing, that this is a new way of doing it, right? So to unfreeze something, you need to create a dissatisfaction with the current status quo, right? You need to see, why should they change? Why should they change? Just because I tell them to? Or there are some good reasons? The change becomes quite easy to work with if you give them a very good reason, right? That is the way you need to work with change, right? Because after all, we are working with human beings. Now we look at different leadership styles, right? You need to, again, I see in your E2 book there are quite a few leadership styles that they have discussed. You may need to just brush up on those and look at it and see, you know, some of the key leadership styles that you want to remember, and the context around it is important for you to understand. Okay. And you can see the Ashridge College model. What is dictatorial? Tell. Autocratic means sell it. But when it comes to democratic, it is more of a consultation, right? But how do you think, when it comes to our case study, how do you think this will work? What kind of leadership style will work, and what is the reasoning behind it? What do you think? What leadership style will work, and what is the reasoning behind it?
In the context of the
our case study, yeah. So first you will look at what type of people are working in our company. So what type of people are working? Are they professionals, high skill or low skill? What sort of people? What sort of people do you think work in our company?
Professional.
Yeah, so we are working with quite a bit professionals, right? Quite a bit of professionals. Because then when you work with the professionals, then you remember there's a tall and flat structure. So that structure changes as well, because you're working with experienced professional people. So it's not that you need to breathe down their necks 24/7, right? Because they like to work independently. They'll work independently. They will deliver the job, deliver what is expected. They don't want you to be going behind them. That's not what they want. But when it comes to unskilled labor, there is a lot of supervision that needs to happen, right? Think of building a house, think of the laborers, where you say, you know, you will see a lot of supervision has to be there when it comes to unskilled labor, right? How does the pestle relate to our case study in this context? The pestle, how does it work? How do you think it'll work? Any reasons? Any logic here? Why would we look at pestle?
Because of our market reach, our market growth.
Mm-hmm. And not only to analyze the current existing market, but also to understand the future markets, right?
Yeah.
And the future markets of your existing one, but also looking at new markets, right? So imagine you need to, if you're looking at you know, the market, you in Dubai, well, what do you think the market is going to be for a particular, let's say, industry in shopping malls? Let's say we have so many retail outlets, in 10 years time, right? Would it be saturated? Would it be still in a growth phase? Would it have, you know, would it decline? So you need to consider those factors as a company, because your investments will be driven by these strategic decisions, because and the decisions are made on, you know, environmental factors, right? External factors, like what is the environment going to look like? What is the legal concepts? Now, they're saying there's going to be a 5% VAT, right, in all GCC countries. So how would that impact us, right? Looking at the political, economical, and social, the trends and fashions and demographics, again, this plays a significant role. Now, why corporate governance? What is corporate governance? I want one of the ladies to be talking to me now. What about the corporate governance? What does it mean? Well, let me pick somebody. Suchi? Or what about Janaki? Are you familiar with corporate governance? Uh, Kumari, what about you? Well, the thing is, you got to be, even if you don't know, give it a go, right? That's the important thing. You don't need to know the answer, but look at it and say, okay, what is corporate governance, right? So give it a go. I want you guys to interact. I want you guys to, because otherwise it is a very difficult thing for you to conceptualize and also put it into writing, okay? Gavin, so what do you think corporate governance is?
Corporate governance is the governance model of an organization. You have various committees, you have various like the audit committee, the remuneration committee, so on and so forth.
Yes. So we will, as a company, you will have a minimum five committees, right? Like the audit committee, like the remuneration committee, right? Nomination committee, right? There will be certain committees that will be there in order for you to have good corporate governance. And there's go on.
And the minimum five committees.
I can't.
Minimum five committees.
Sorry.
There should be a minimum of five committees?
There is, there, yes, it is there in the book where it says that, like, and also if you look at companies like Marks and Spencer, I'm picking Marks and Spencer because if you look at their annual report, it's fantastic because they very well articulate the type of committees they have, right? And it is very clear, in you know, so I do have a copy of it. I'll stick it in your Dropbox as well because it's interesting to see how they elaborate on their accounting treatments and also the different committees. And here what they talk about is how do you govern the company, right? How effective it is. So it'll give you a very good idea whether your current company is effectively governed or not. Okay. The SAFS model is another very good model that we can use for investments, right? If you are doing a project, if you're planning on an investment, this will give you that kind of structure that that you can put into. Now, if I say I'm going into investing in a massive project, you will look at, well, is it, you know, is it suitable? Does it link to the company's strategic objectives, right? That's one of the first things you ask. If it doesn't, then you say, well, if it doesn't link to the strategic objectives, why are we trying to doing it? What is the reasoning behind it, right? Because most of the time you say, well, you know, it doesn't make sense to do this project because it doesn't give you a strategic objective. Is it feasible, right, that we do this? Do we have constraints? Do we have all the resources available to in order for us to carry it out? Then we look at acceptability. We look at, will it be accepted by the stakeholders, our community, our shareholders, right? Is it something that will get accepted? And last, is it sustainable, right? Sustainability plays a big role as well. Yes, Wilfred. Any question?
No, I'm good.
Yeah, okay.
Clear.
Now, why would we look at Ansoff Matrix in this? Why would Ansoff Matrix play a role in this case study? What will it give us? Yes?
It will give us advantage on our products, like by having a, like how we want to approach the market, like with according to our pricing strategy and other things.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone else?
You can go market penetration, or you develop new markets, or you develop new products, or a diversification. Then we move to a different product.
Right, so it will give you actually another framework to ask the question how the company needs to grow, right? How are we going to be growing, right? So are we going to grow, like penetrate the existing market via existing, with the existing products? Are we going to bring in new products into the market, right? Then we look at, well, we have fantastic product, so therefore can we go outside into a new market completely? And you go into a diversification strategy. So if you look at our current market, current company, what do you think they can do? What do you think that they can do? Any idea? Well, let us go through. So remember this in mind when we go through our case study, right? Because it's important. Now we go into our ethics, right? When we look at, this is the kind of framework. If there is a situation, we look at, you know, how are we going to answer the questions, right? Is it ethical? Look at all your facts first, right? Then you ask the question, is it ethical, right? Well, is there an ethical issue involved here? Is there a dilemma, right? Is it legal? So sometimes it's legal but not ethical, right? Identify what fundamental principles are affected. Now, examiner goes on telling us that, you know, some of the people are not very familiar with the ethics, the principles. So this is an area that I want to spend more time on, right? And I want to ask the question from you guys, do you know the principles, the ethical principles? Right. Can anybody give me some of the principles? Right. So what we will do is, this is a topic that I will expand on, right? Ethics, so that you will get more familiar with it. And then you look at the affected parties, right? Who are the people who are affected by this situation, right? What are the possible causes of action available, internal as well as external? Right, if you're not able to kind of come to a conclusion, and also, you know, you think that you're not going to get a proper answer, you need to seek professional advice, and then you disassociate from that particular conflict area as well, right? So it is you can come across these things when it comes to vendor negotiations, or also you can come across when you have a very strong chairman or a senior person in the board, where he pushes you to a situation that you're supposed to act, and you do it because because of peer pressure. And then, is it ethical? You ask the question, right? This is related to enterprise risk management. It's more into looking into what are the risks associated from a company perspective, then from a project perspective, right? We look at different types of risks, and then you look at how do you manage these risks. This risk cycle is that SEMA has put out, which is very effective, gives us again a framework to work with, right? See, identify the risk, understand and assess the scale of the risk, because all of us can come up with 10,000 risks, right? Not a problem. But what is the scale of the risk, right? The probability. Then develop a risk response strategy. How are we going to respond to this risk? How are we going to mitigate this risk, right? Then we need to implement a strategy and allocate certain resources, right? Implementation and monitoring of controls. Now, not only we understand that what the risk is, we've understood how to mitigate it, but also we need to go on monitoring as well. And then we need to regularly do reviewing, right? And say, is there a better way to do things, right? So is there anybody here who works in a bank? Yeah. Gavin, so risk is a very big thing in your area, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So from a bank's perspective, it looks at the credit risk, right?
Not really. You have credit risk, operation risk, security.
Yes.
And
yeah. There are many aspects like operational.
There are
yeah.
Many aspects.
Yeah.
Operation risk, fraud risk. Say for instance, credit card.
Mm-hmm.
There are so much of fraud, you know.
Yes.
You can't stop everything. So.
Yes.
So you try to, you know, minimize. Yes. You do strategies, see from which country that is coming through, and then you know, and then you have your learning and development where you, you know, get start to, you know, as soon as you see a transaction, it's alert. Or but this is part of it.
Correct.
This is just one component. One component of.
Right. I want to go here first. This is what you mentioned, right? You look at what sort of a risk do we face. A company will face different types of risks. You look at the financial, is it hazardous, strategic risks and operational risks, right? And in our company, there's opportunity to talk about all of these risks. And then we look at, well, how are we going to mitigate this risk? And this is where we have this TARA model, transfer, accept, control, or abandoned, right? These risks. So this is a mitigation strategy, the structure as to how, what are we going to do about it? Yeah. So anyone else?
Is that an IT company? Huh?
Yes, it is. It is an IT company.
And they store data and all that.
Correct.
They store data.
Yeah. So there is just plenty of.
Yeah, there was an article in the paper where you know what they do, they block your data. They come onto your server, block your data, and they blackmail you for to release the data.
Correct.
They put small amounts actually.
Yes.
Recently I heard it somewhere, you know, they just. So, you know, so what do? Do you pay? Do you not pay? And then what stops them doing it, not doing it again?
Correct. Yeah, it's quite a dilemma, isn't it? And that's where the ethical aspects also will come into play. And then, you know, in this particular scenario, this is an IT company, we will be storing others' data as well, you know.
Exactly, yeah.
How, what is that? Exactly, yeah.
Confidentiality.
Correct. Correct. And
then we're just asking very small amounts, like $1,000, $2,000, $3,000.
Right.
Small companies.
Yeah.
Data.
Yeah. So we will have a lot of opportunity to look at the industry as well. Now we go into how to analyze the pre-scene. Okay. Review each page, highlight the key topics. What are the spaces given for the this is interesting. So if they talk one whole page about risk, that means they're very, very interested about the risk, and there will be some questions on that as well. If they're talking about a corporate governance, a whole page, then that's also something that you know, you need to look into. What I have seen is quite interesting in your case, where you get position descriptions, right? Also there, so this is interesting.
What is it Andrew said? Position description?
Position descriptions I've seen. Let's have a look at it again. We look at the past trends, the past exams as well, and then we look at how issues have been tackled, right? You need to look at the pre-seen and see what models can be applied, right? And you need to be very familiar with the models and be able to apply to different scenarios, right? Just saying, okay, this is five forces. These are the five forces. This is what they talk about. That's not going to earn you any marks, right? It's the application that's going to earn you marks. So we will be doing quite a bit of questions. We'll go through it then, right? And then analyze the key points, its advantages and disadvantages as well, right? So that ends the high level structure, right? But now I want to take you to another area, which is, let me close this one. Right, just give me a moment because so let me share my screen again with you. So as homework, what I want you to do is certainly go through the case study by tomorrow. We will do as much as we can today, but then you will see the way I'm analyzing the case study. I want you to do a similar way and create notes, right? Write down notes and bring it to class tomorrow so that we can discuss, and then I'm going to give you questions as well. Right? So let us look into this. It's basically actually three elements, right? And you look at the overall grading, and it's a scaled score that's given. And it will be indication is strong, moderate, or you have failed, right? Now, this one of the difficult things to understand is if you failed and you got moderate in all the competencies, right? And we will see what would have happened to you, right, in this case. What do you need to achieve if you want to pass? Like, few things. You need to score above 80, right? It has to be strong, moderate grades, high, right? Strong as well as moderate. And you need to have touched each competency, more so in technical than the rest, right? You need to basically then see, well, if you're writing the answer, you need to have a clear answer plan, right? You will fail if you score obviously less than 80 and you have not achieved the minimum competence threshold, right? So then what actually has happened, right? When you have scored moderate and failed, because I had quite a few students who were saying to me, you know what, I had moderate in all the competencies. But what has happened is maybe you have not answered all parts of the question, right? So as you know, there will be one question, but there are multiple parts in that question. So you have to be very careful and answer all the parts, right? And when you're doing your questions with me, this is something you need to understand and look out for as well, right? And then you look at what is strong, means you have really integrated well across the subjects and the competencies. It's working pretty good. And moderate means you exceed the minimum competency, but you have not given enough depth and breadth of the whole area. Fail means, of course, you not achieve the minimum competencies. Now, when I look at your answer, the first half of the bullet points is talking about your technical ability of the answer, right? And the second part, second half of the bullets are talking about your how you market your answer to your examiner. It may sound a bit strange, but you know, let us look at it and then you'll understand why you need to market this answer to the examiner, right? Now, the first thing is, have you got your requirements correctly interpreted, right? Many a time, students will interpret the requirements incorrectly, right? Have you answered all the components of the questions, right? You need to give a logical answer, right? You need to have theory, principles, and apply it, right? Now, the last one is conform to formats required. What does that mean? Does anybody know? What does that mean? Wilfred, what do you think?
Reports.
Sorry?
I think if you have been told by preparing a report or yeah, answering to an email or research.
Mm-hmm. Yes, if they tell you to write to come up with a slide pack, a slide deck, you shouldn't write it in a way you do an essay type answer. Right, they will fail you again because I've asked you for something, you've given something else. If they say a report format, follow the report format. If they tell you follow the I want a email, write an email. Okay, now the last one points is purely on marketing. Write short, concise sentences, less punctuations, because don't write very long sentences because you yourself will get confused, so would the examiner, right? Headings and subheadings should be there, so you make it easier for the examiner to give you marks, right? Short paragraphs, again, you're making it easy for him to read, okay? And make separate paragraphs for each point. Remember, if you put 2-3 points together in one paragraph, he will miss it, right? So you're making it again easy for the examiner to see this, right? Selective underlining. Don't go underlining everything, right? Then what's the importance? Nothing. Answer within time, right? So when you finish, you're supposed to allocate certain time. You need to finish off at that time. Now, if there are 4 points that they want you to talk on, and you come to the second point, and which is a very favorite topic of yours, you should not spend the rest of the time talking about that particular topic and forgetting the rest other two. If you do, again, this is where you get a moderate answer, because the examiner will look at it and say, out of 100, you answered only 2. So you will get 50 marks, right? So be careful. Now, when it comes to the answer the question. There's no magic behind it, right? We will have a lot of questions in your class. What I want you to do is prepare and do the answer. Volunteer to showcase your answer scripts. Okay, volunteer to demonstrate and share your screen and showcase, because the more you do it, because then we can provide feedback, right? A strategic question will ask for a different approach from an operational question, because a strategic means it's a very more complex, operation is very transactional, right? Now, this is the examiner's report, November 2015, and November 2015 was also on an IT company, right? We will be looking at that particular company a little bit and also looking at their questions as well. Not to say that they are going to repeat the questions. Please know, they will not, right? Overall standard of answer presented was lower than in August 2015 exam session. There were many short and incomplete solutions. Poor understanding of several syllabus areas such as value chain, balance scorecard, leasing, and share prices. So many issues here, right? Now, I must say, the industry that they have chosen is not the most common industry which all of us will understand, right? So we need to put in extra effort. However, there are advantages in doing this case study as well. The reason is, if it's a little bit difficult for us, it'll be difficult for everybody. Okay, so the more you're prepared, the more you do research, it's easier for us, right? We will know what it is all about. Some candidates had written very little and did not always demonstrate understanding of the requirements, right? Again, you've not understood what the examiner is asking. Now, I want you guys to either write to me directly or put it in the chat box if you don't understand any of these areas like value chain, balance scorecard, right? And some of the models that I have shown. If you don't understand, please write, because it's important. I will again have a separate, you know, during the session, I'll go through that. Some clearly revised specific topics and were determined to work them into their answers, despite the fact that they were not relevant. Now, I had some students last year who were asking me, can you give me some paragraphs to memorize? So I was like quite confused, right? And say, what do you mean you need to? No, then we can apply that into the questions that the examiner is asking in our answers. I said, you know, this is very strange. In CIMA, we do not have something like this. We cannot memorize certain things and just apply, right? So certain paragraphs you can't memorize and apply, and that's where the examiner is picking up on you. Okay. Any questions so far? So if you look at this middle section, that's the role that you're performing, the manager role, right? The management, you can see the technical competencies are much more, 39%, as opposed to the others, right? So your technical skills have to be quite up there, right? Now, let's look at your marking guide. What are the technical skills that they're looking at? Okay. In this case, they have looked at activity-based management, integrating accounting, fair value accounting, transfer pricing. This is in one of the exams, right? This is how they have marked. Strategic analysis, marketing implications are also important. Those are the business skills. Then they've looked also as integrating a negotiation with unions, planning for strikes, right? People skills. So, you know, if you have manufacturing, you need to think of, you know, if there is going to be some strikes, how are you going to manage that, right? And then you look at the change management aspect as well, right?
And
now,
what's the 2015
this one, no, one of the, this is an example of one of
generic
example, yeah. But we will be going through different variants, and we'll have a look at it and see how they are testing you on each of these areas, right? But looking at it, when you look at your role, right, you're in the management accounting, preparing budgets, but also you're doing costing and pricing decisions for special projects. So if you're doing special projects, you're definitely going into this change management, right? Then you look at strategic analysis, market implications, right? These are areas that you will be looking at, yeah? So, now let me go into the case study itself. Give me a second. Well, it has a very nice name, Spark Space, right? Good name. Let's look at what they're talking about. So this is your role, overseeing management accounting function, preparing budgets, drawing up costs, and advising pricing for specific projects. Now, just looking at this, what sort of questions do you think that you can foresee coming your way? What do you think?
Appraisal.
Yeah, go on. Yeah. Yes, Gavin.
Project appraisals, maybe.
Project appraisal. Yeah, what
pricing,
else?
Pricing strategy.
Yeah. Anything else? Then we also look at, they're talking about management accounting function. Right? Overseeing the management accounting.
Yeah.
So analytics. Product profitability analysis, right? Things like that is very, very common here. Now, let me go to the second one and see what they're talking about. Spark Space supplies and supports IT infrastructure, primarily in the form of servers, right? So, when this whole page they're talking about, the type of activity that they do, right? So they give servers, right? And basically what they do is support IT supplies and support IT infrastructure, right? And so in this case, what are some of the issues that they can come across according to what they're selling? So they're selling, yeah, that there's a risk, right? Because they're saying support and supply and support. And infrastructure. So if you read, if you had read, you know, further down, you will say the type of clients they have are quite high end. You know, the type of what they do, the activities that they do. So if you they need to be quite careful in what they give to these clients as well, right? And then they say Spark Space acts as a value-added reseller, right, between the major hardware manufacturers and the main
industry.
Yeah. Now, if you look at the hardware industry that they've got, what sort of a, you know, if you look at it from a management accounting point of view, it's a very generic product. They want to become the cost leader, right? What do you think? The manufacturers. So manufacturers are going after kind of low price, right? Bulk manufacturing and low price. Am I right?
Yeah.
Right? Bulk manufacturing, so in order to get low price, yeah. Then what does Park Space do here?
They market the product to the end user.
Right, and what sort of a value-added service do they give?
They not only supply the items but also do maintenance and continuous service.
Right, so they do maintenance and continuous service, right? So, for example, imagine we are like, let's say, IBM Lenovo, right? The product, the Lenovo product. Instead of, you know, we trying to be one amongst millions of to the manufacturer, if we buy this product and if there is somebody who's going to give us a great service, we might as well go to that person, right? So this is where Spark Space is adding that value, right? What else? You can see that Spark Space, as well as the manufacturers, get together to come up with a very specialist product as well, right? To certain clients, yeah. And that is basically creating a differentiation as well, yeah. So the hardware rarely makes direct sales to the end users, preferring to sell their products through value-added resellers, right? So there, what is in this case, there is an opportunity for Spark Space. Another opportunity. What is that? What is that? Can you see that?
They have many vendors, so they can get competitive price and good scope.
Yes. Now you might also get a question saying, well, why won't Spark Space go into manufacturing? What do you think of that? What do you think of that? Why
There might
can't
be
they do it?
opportunity that might be.
They can tie up with some other company who's already manufacturing and then create a new product according
Yes.
to the requirement of the end user.
Right. So what you're saying is create a joint venture, right?
Yeah.
Rather than you go on your own by doing that, what happens? What by do, going into a joint venture, what happens?
Knowledge is shared,
And
cost is reduced,
yeah, risk is reduced.
is
Risk
shared.
is also reduced. Risk
Yes.
is shared.
Yes. Yeah. Shared and reduced as well, because you have never been in that game, right? As much. Manufacturer knows he has been in that game for a long time, so he will know exactly what are the pitfalls are and allow and tell you this is not something that we should be doing, right? So Spark Space has considerable expertise in design and building its own bespoke servers that meet very specific demanding requirements, unlike major hardware vendors. So hardware vendors can go into that massive, like masses, right? They manufacture in mass, right? That's what they're good at.
Sorry.
Yeah.
By doing that, wouldn't they share their USP? Now they do desktop servers. Now there is a very, the manufacturer.
Mm-hmm.
So these guys have the end user. They do customization of the server by going for a JV with one of the manufacturers.
Mm-hmm.
I was just thinking out of the box.
Yes.
Would it be diluting their USP, the unique position or the niche position of being an expertise?
Right. What about, I want to throw that question out to the audience and see what they will answer. How about you, Janaki? What do you think? Do you think it'll dilute?
Sorry, pardon me, I didn't understand that.
Right.
Question.
So what Gavin was saying is by this guy, Sparkspace, creating a joint venture, right, with someone, they will reveal all the secrets and everything, that unique knowledge that they have, they will be sharing with these guys, and that will actually open up another market for these joint venture people and the other party. And it is an issue for Sparkspace because you're inviting more competition. What do you think? Is it correct? Is it a correct statement? Or if there is something like that, how can we mitigate?
No, both the parties will go into deep study about this, whether if I disclose what will happen tomorrow, whether he will steal the knowledge or he will be with me. Everything they will consider before getting into the joint venture. The plus and minus. Unless it's beneficial to both the parties, they will not get into the venture.
Yeah, so one of the things, I mean, it's a good point, and it's a case of, how do you manage your contract with the other party? Exactly. Yes.
Could be put as a risk and a mitigant as well.
I beg your pardon?
Could be highlighted as a risk factor and a mitigant as well.
Correct. Yes. Agreement. Yeah. Yeah. So the thing is, it is a good point, but there are ways to mitigate. And you can see nowadays a lot of the so-called competitors getting together to work together and share resources because it makes sense. Right, it doesn't make sense to compete at times, because especially when it comes to unique knowledge like this, very specialized, they need to work together, right? Now, as you can see, Sparkspace clients are also very specialist in nature, right? They run very complex engineering simulations, like oil and gas people, right? And they talk about, further on, the type, other different weather patterns, things like that, right? Now, this is the kind of stuff that they do: pre-sales, consultancy, installation, maintenance, assembly, right? They go from a pre-sales point of view, they work with the client to ensure that the client gets the best deal, right? The client has the correct specification, they understand what it is they want, and then these guys work with them to procure it, right? So basically playing a consultant role in the client's work. Right. And here there is another one comment that they've made. The parent company is 100% owner of a number of subsidiaries. Bear in mind that. Okay. And how do they assemble? Right. So corporate IT systems have changed dramatically since the days. The previous 10 years, 15 years, right? Things have changed drastically. So basically what we need to know is these servers, what are the issues? I mean, you have, they are in racks, the blade servers, whatever you can call different names if you like. But there is something when it comes to these servers that you need to be aware of. What do you think that is? The thing is the power they emit, the consumption of power, as well as when it comes to the heat energy that they produce as well, right? So these are two things that need to be aware of and see how can they reduce it, right? Because as part of CSR, this should be a target and they should be reducing it, right? And that will also play a role when it comes to them designing this type of products to their clients. Yeah? And the racks are standard size and large in large data centers. They can have many racks that are interconnected as clusters. Again, what does it mean? Don't get too hung up on these technical terms. What you need to understand is I'm putting everything in one space. That is a risk. So in order to manage that, I may need to have different data centers, right? So in that case, my cost is going to increase. And in order to manage, if I'm going into different regions as well, maybe I'll have to have different data centers in different parts of the world, right? Now, this part is talking about Sparkspace assembly line is semi-automated, right? So this part talks about their manufacturing, right? It's semi-automated. Installation is quick and easy when the racks are delivered to the client, right? They also say process is also crucial in allowing Sparkspace to apply its own highly innovative and patent mega board to any configuration, right? They also talk about what this mega board does, right? And the developing server technology mean that clusters have become smaller, faster, and cheaper. Now, despite the growth in available power, the demand for Sparkspace servers continue to rise, right? So this means their sales are doing pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right? They're doing pretty good. So they are saying the Sparkspace assembly line are at near 100% capacity. Now, this tells a very big story to us. Tell me what it is. What does it, as a management accountant, it's jumping at you. This is what, you know, it's telling you a story, but not in so many words. Wilfred, what do you think?
It tells about the workload, like how much much project you have, like what are you, the workload basically, like.
Okay, what else? Janaki, what do you think?
There is.
Yeah, go on, Wilfred, go on.
Our resources also will be like blocked for so many servers or projects, particularly. Mm-hmm. So that's.
Okay. And then, what about, there's something else here. What do you think?
Backlog.
Yeah, that can
there
be
is
a
no backlog.
So
excess demand will have a problem.
Yes.
Like if they get a bigger order,
yeah,
then things will be difficult to handle.
Right. So then what do we do?
Growth constraints, the problem is the breakdown.
Sorry, I can't hear you, Gavin.
There is growth constraints. The company cannot grow anymore. So therefore the systems are, they work 24/7.
Yeah.
They get a breakdown, they say orders can be up.
Mm-hmm.
Special issues, delays, penalties.
Yes. Okay.
So this gives you the opportunity. There can be a question because this is a huge opportunity for you to invest to increase capacity, right? Immediately it opens up an investment opportunity into expanding. So then we need to look at how to fund and then ROI and so on and so forth in this situation.
And so these guys manufacture these base servers, these small servers. That's what they manufacture, no?
So what they're saying, development in server to mean, yeah. So they're saying, yeah, according, you know, for their particular product, their lines are 100% full, nearly, yeah. Now, another area is they're saying this, the system was built for Westland Meteorological System, contained 50,000 blade servers. I mean, the relationship or the contacts they have for these other clients, their clients, this is very specialist clients. So these are not just individuals like you and I, right? They need very high-end products and in big volume, okay? Supercomputers and data processing. This is also a very interesting area because they talk about the data processing and why do you need supercomputers, and also they're looking at big data, right? They talk about big data, and you know, with big data, what does it mean? You need to have huge servers with very big capacity because that's the type of data you're bringing in. So it's not everybody who can afford this. It's not everybody who can afford this. However, now they're coming into a situation where you are able to pay for what you consume, right? Rather than you purchase these supercomputers, right? This is that interesting part that we are coming into. And they talk about groundbreaking work on the energy consumption of HPC devices has enabled Spark Space to improve efficiency of the power supplies. Now, this part talks about, you know, what I mentioned, how much energy particular computers use, right? So if I'm able to reduce it, this is fantastic, right? With these new technologies, you're able to reduce it, saying 30%, right? Energy consumption represents 30% of the computing center's operating costs. That is massive amount, right? 30%. So if I can reduce some part of it, I'm gonna gain. Right, they're also involved in different research activities as well. Right, now let us go into Spark Innovate. Now, when I look at this, I need to look at R&D and how to treat it. Right, any ideas? The accounting treatment,
it's basically planned for next coming 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
The return is expected in around 10 years.
Right, okay.
Long-term investment, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So the accounting treatment, what would be the accounting treatment?
You'll show it as investment, no, in the beginning.
Okay, so this is an area that I want to go a little bit more as well. Right, because they are talking about R&D. I want to see how the accounting treatment is currently, or where can we go into, what are the other you know, any latest developments in R&D. Okay, so let us explore that in the next classes, yeah, because it's going to be quite important for us, right? So Spark Innovate is a very good initiative, and also Spark Innovative is important for Spark Space, right? Because it goes hand in hand, right? They need some innovative, that innovative ideas, the stream needs to come through. Now, if you look at this, they will see, how does Spark Space achieve the client's needs, right? every project undertaken by Spark Space is unique and offers its own challenges, right? So what does this mean to us? So if you're looking at a particular project, right, each project will have a separate risk factor, right? You need to see the discounting factor may change, right? Because what they say is it is very unique, right? Each project is unique. So hence, depending on the risk profile, my discounting factor also will change, right? And what else can you see from here? Anything else that's significant here that you can see? The last paragraph is about that big data I was talking about. Right? The last paragraph. So in that context, now we are going into an area where we say, well, big data should be available to everybody, irrespective of, you know, affordability, because now they're bringing that affordability to everybody, right? Previously, it was available only to a select few, because not only in the cost of infrastructure, but also the resources who do the work, it's very scarce to find, right? Now we look at friendly pay, right? How does friendly pay come into this scenario? So you can see that these guys, again, work with Spark Space, right? Because they are, again, they want some specialist servers for the type of activities that they do, right? So hence, they work with Spark Space to work and to develop, come up with new things, right? It is important that, you know, that Spark Space come up with innovative things, again, new things to accommodate friendly pay's requirements, right? So in that context, you will see we need to have, again, a very innovative type of environment and employees, right? Engagement has to be very, very high. It needs to be a very creative environment for them to work and come up with these innovative ideas. What about these Westland meteorological systems? What do you think of those? Janaki, what do you think?
It's about weather forecasting, no?
Sorry?
About weather forecasting.
Okay.
Application.
So what does Spark Space do here? What do you think they do here?
They compute a lot of data.
Right. And again, provide that specialist service, right? And you can see with the innovative systems and innovative things, instead of taking 2 hours previously, the system took 2 hours, now it takes only 4 minutes, right? So they come up every time they are trying to improve their what they do and support the client. So these are the things that make the clients want to stay with them, and also want to, I know, word of mouth, it improves, right? So the future, what does Spark Space's future offer, all right? Undoubted success in the HPC market has led to creative collaborations. For example, processor manufacturer Memo Chip has designated Sparkspace as its preferred vendor for its chipset codenamed Days Liftoff, right? So it seems like they have a very good reputation in the market, right? And because of that, there are lots of collaborations going on with Sparkspace, whether it's a chipset or whether it's with certain clients, right? We've seen this. Now, we look at the directors, who the directors are, right? And then we look at their SWOT analysis. Now, something that's really interesting that's happening in the last two consecutive sessions in the exams is I can see that they give a list of, they give the SWOT, they also give the risks to the company, right? So in this case, they don't ask us to look for the SWOT or the risks. They give it. But what they're looking for then is an answer which is far more superior and quite strategic in nature, because, and also looking at a better analysis, right? Because you don't have to search for the strengths, you don't have to search for weaknesses. Now, if I look at the strengths of Sparkspace, what are the opportunities that you see? Let me come, I want one of you to come up with an opportunity that you see that can be explored.
Professional expertise?
Yes. So how can you,
knowledge.
Yeah, now how can you use that? In what context can I exploit it?
Yeah, it's a change is inevitable in these days. Technology is changing every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
So expert professional can understand the new change and apply immediately wherever required.
Mm-hmm.
The knowledge.
Mm-hmm. How can I improve my strategic objectives, or how can I improve my business with these trends? In what context? How can I do that?
Customer loyalty.
Yeah.
Customer loyalty, like making a point of difference, bespoke, like working and provide
as
for their requirements.
Yes. So that's a good one where you're saying, imagine there are lots of, you have very good staff, right? Professional expertise. So this means you need to have some good clients as well, because this staff like to work on specialist projects, right? They want to have creative things, they want to do interesting things. So what they want to do is have some really good clients and good collaborations, so that exactly to what your point, you are the arm of that other company, right? IT specialist arm. They don't need to hire or keep people on a full-time basis, right? So when they want something, they will work with you, and you have the specialist staff, and you're able to deliver, right? I mean, certain, you would see professionals, like the IT professionals, they really do not want to come and work in a particular company, right? Like performing support services, because it's a boring job, right? They want to work with the likes of either Infosys or Tata, or, you know, a big IT company where they will say, well, you know, there are a lot of clients, they do a lot of projects, and they're interested in that because that supports their career as well, right? So you can see now by looking at the SWOT, you can see what are the things that we can do, right? If I look at my opportunities, it's a growing market, worldwide interest in technology, potential to exploit innovations from research and development, but what does it mean? Right, there's a lot of opportunity, but also in order for us to exploit those opportunities, there's something else that we require. What do we require? Anybody?
Research and development.
Okay, anyone else? What else? I have great opportunity. What do we require? Yes.
Funding, you know, technical.
So, yeah, I think you said funding, right? Yeah, so definitely. Now, do we have the money? Right? It's great opportunity, great things going on. Do I have the money? Do I have the skill set to not to do the activity, but to perform from a business standpoint, to move to the next level, to operate, right? Do I have the skill set? Sometimes I do, you know, in certain ways, I do have the skill set to operate in one geographic location, and that's about it. I don't have skill set to become a multinational. So you need to understand, do they have that, right? Do I have the funding, right? So now you can see how we look at the SWOT and then ask questions and pose questions as well and explore, do we have these things going on, right? The threats are rapidly growing competitors, new sources of competition, low cost substitutes, low margins, high marketing spend on competitors, right? So, in order to avoid this, what do we have to do?
That is saying the customer.
Yes, and
establishing relationship with the customers.
Yeah.
Then by good relationship, by word of their customer will refer another customer, like that they can expand.
Yeah.
In fact, people don't mind paying an extra money if they get a good service as they require.
Correct. Now, they are in a good space because they are working with very specialist customers as well, right? So this is a time of customers that they should be looking for, not people like you and me who are consumers, right? But because you need high-end customers who provide a specialist information, data, and things like that, right? And that's a good market, that because even though the market is you know, very competitive, however, this type of people producing this type of information, you know, the services that they offer may not be too many, because you need specialist professionals, right? So in order to attract specialist professionals, you need to have a very good environment. Yeah, so your people need to be very creative, and you know, their whole game lies in the people, right? If the people are not there to provide this kind of service, this kind of knowledge, if they're not there, they're whole business will come to an end, right? This is a big problem. So actually, even though you think technology is the key, not really. Your people are also a very key aspect. Yeah, so that's something that it will come across. Now, what I want to do is stop at this point and then leave the CEO's report, etc., for tomorrow. But I'm gonna have some questions ready for you tomorrow. So what I want you to do is thoroughly read this case study, what we've done, so that you know you're prepared with you know, to do the questions. And in the meantime, if you're not sure about any models that we've gone through, please write to me or put it in the chat so that I can take it up separately. Okay?
Great.
Okay then.
Okay.
All right.
Same time tomorrow, no?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, good night.
Good night.
Bye. Bye.